All good. Okay, your 15 minutes starts now.
Okay. I'm Wilco Bernhoffman. I'm going to talk to you about SpaceNet. It's a federated authentication for secure roaming wireless network access across hackerspaces and these kind of community events. Yes, slide please. So the SpaceNet is part of SpaceFed, which is a federated platform for authentication across hackerspaces and hacker events. So I'm going to talk to you about a little bit about SpaceFed and then SpaceNet and tell you why it's useful and how it does work and what kind of security it actually offers and what it does not offer. And also how you can help with setting up some more federated projects. Slide, please. Okay. We started in November 2011, but the idea actually came on earlier to do this, the federated hackerspace thing. One of the things we had was like we were at a hacker event and everybody was sniffing everybody else's traffic. And we thought, well, there must be a better way to do this while still providing proper security and also to be anonymous. That's when we actually got together and thought about how we're going to do this. And also to have some sort of roaming access. If I open my laptop at another hackerspace, I want it to just work, but I don't want everything to be public, just out of the box. I mean, for me, it doesn't matter. I use a VPN anyway, but most people do not. So it will actually offer just a little bit of more extra security. SpaceFed is a federated authentication platform. We try to do everything as decentralized as we can possibly do it. So there's SpaceNet, which is basically WPA2 enterprise with radius access and roaming, where you can actually go to your own hackerspace and authenticate there. And then your home hackerspace will say to the current Wi-Fi solution you're on, will say, this user is OK. I don't know who it is. I'm not going to tell you who it is, but this is a user is OK, which is good. Another one of the projects that we do is we're going to do some SAML. We've actually already started doing SAML to link all the authentication and, again, not have the password on our infrastructure, but only to your home server and that you have at your own hackerspace or hacker community. And that will tell us, OK, this user is OK. And we do not want to know your password. All we want to have is the assertion you're OK. So another one is Space Connect, which is basically a decentralized VPN in pretty much the same way, and some phone systems that we're going to link. So basically, it's all inter-hackerspace related projects that we're trying to do under one single umbrella of cooperation between the hackerspace. Slide, please. So this talk is about SpaceNet, well, federated authentication, blah, blah, blah. It's a bit like Aderome. How many people here know Aderome? Okay, so I'm going to have to explain it anyway. It's WPA2 Enterprise, which basically means that you are going to be able to log on to a Wi-Fi with your username and password and not with a pre-shared key. And the advantage is that the pre-shared key is not actually used to set up your session key. So your session key comes from the radius server, and that will mean you're more secure than you are with a PSK, because public Wi-Fi with a pre-shared key is not actually offering more security than just public Wi-Fi, because the pre-shared key will be used to encrypt the session key. And from then on, if you have the initial negotiation with the pre-shared key, you're screwed anyway. The main thing it does is it allows you to specify your username. In my case, Wilco@bitlayer.nl. and it will just go to BitLayer, authenticate me, and it will toss back, it's okay. So username and password. One of the advantages is you can configure it once, and you can actually use it everywhere. And if you use the certificate checking of your home radius server, since it's actually a TLS tunnel, it will be as secure as you can get it right now, the current state of technology. So it's essentially a radius proxy. Slide, please. Okay, so why is it useful? Well, it's very easy to use. You can configure it once, use everywhere. It works on most clients. I've actually not seen clients that do not work fundamentally. Some clients require some hacks to get it working, but yeah, that's a client issue, I'm afraid. It is secure. Well, secure as we can get it right now. Keys are dynamic, so no session keys. Every user gets a single session with a secure handshake, which is good. It works at all connected spaces and events like this one. I could just open up my laptop, and we have SpaceNet here right now. And my laptop will just connect to the Wi-Fi, and my session will be encrypted. And I don't have to worry about anyone sniffing my traffic up until the gateway, actually, or until we actually hit the wired network. So that's good. Right now, we have spaces connected in the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Germany, United Kingdom, and also some events we did in Malaysia, Hack in a Box. And well, hopefully your space will be connected next week as well. That would be great. If you have if you don't have a country node yet, because it's all federated and delegated to every single country, so just contact us and we can work something out to connect you as well. It can regulate your network access, which is good. It can do wired as well. You can do 802.1x authentication on your wired ports. You can actually do some useful stuff like saying, hey, this is a guest user because this is not from my realm. It is from, for example, RefSpace. And you can, no, I don't trust these RefSpace guys. I'm going to put them in a different VLAN. It will just work if your access point supports this kind of stuff. So you can determine pretty much based on which server you're authenticating with, what VLAN it will go into or not if you trust everyone equally. Slide, please. So this is basically the layout of how this works. You are at the bottom left, connected to the local access point. The access point will do, or actually your client will do an EAP all session. That's EAP over LAN, extensible authentication protocol. And it will make a connection to your access point. The access point will make a radius connection, and the radius will see, hey, this realm is not my local realm, so we'll forward it to the country node. In this case, the would be the German node. That will see, hey, this is user is bitlayer.nl, and bitlayer.nl should be forwarded to the Dutch node, NL node, which will see, hey, oh wait, this is bitlayer.nl, that's this server, and will connect me to my home radius. And from then on, I'm connected to the proper server. I will do a TLS session. So I will have an encrypted end-to-end connection with my home radius, and then I'm sending my username and password to my home server, and just my home server. And it's TLS encrypted. You have to check the certificate, or otherwise you don't know who you're sending your password to. So configure your client that you're actually checking the certificate. And then basically it will say, okay, this user is okay, and we'll forward this back to the home, to the country node of the home radius, back to the country node of the country you're actually in, and to the local radius, and your access point will just say, okay, you are good, you can be on my Wi-Fi, and this is your session key for now, and that way will actually be secure. So next slide, please.
It's 5 minutes.
Yep. So how does it work? Proxying is based on the domain name in your identity, actually in your outer identity. There's actually two kinds of identity here. You have the one inside the TLS session and one outside of the TLS session. The one on the outside, which is in my case, would be something like anonymous@bitlayer.nl. And that one is only used to proxy to the proper server. So it does not actually reveal your identity on the network. It will just pass it through to your home radius. And from there on, it's your inner identity that you do authentication with. So there's no link between the two. So you can actually be anonymous. It's a TLS session, which I just explained. The authorization to actually connect comes from the radius server, and it will actually hand out the session key to the client via EPOL, and then there's some profit involved. Next slide. Okay, so who do I have to trust? That's also always a good question. Well, definitely not us, because we do not get your passwords, which is basically a common theme between all the SpaceFed projects. We do not want your passwords, and actually we do not want you to trust us. Actually, the only thing you should trust us with is that we will only connect hacker spaces and hacker communities, and that's the only level of trust you have to have in us, so that you know, okay, this person comes from SpaceNet, so it must be some sort of hacker-related community that's actually going to do the authorization. But it is as secure as the weakest link. Yes, over the air will be secure using WPA2 Enterprise, but SpaceNet in and of itself does not protect against layer 2 networking attacks. So if you are going to set up your own wireless, you have to check for things like ARP spoofing, rogue DHCP, neighbor discovery spoofing, and rogue router advertisements. Those are things that can still hijack your session, despite the fact that your link is encrypted. So you can have some monitoring for that, or you can have some infrastructure that's actually already protected against this sort of attack. So it is as secure as the weakest link, obviously. But at least over the air is secure. You can't just sniff out a packet through the air, which is good. The default gateway administrator, yeah, that's your link to the internet. If everybody has access on your default gateway box, and well, then obviously everyone can see the traffic. So secure it or not and tell people, but yeah. Of course, the identities are anonymous. I don't even know who you are. I don't have your password. I don't know who you are. All I know is this guy, RefSpace or Random Data, actually says this user is okay. Well, that's good enough for me. You can get on my wireless. Only the home radius actually knows who you are. That's good. It's the next best thing to VPNs. Of course, it's not as secure as a VPN where you control the entire chain, but at least you control it up to the wired network that the sniffing will not be possible yet. Obviously, yet. Next slide, please. Yes, MSChap v2. If you want to support Windows clients, you have to support MSChap v2. Or use a tool called Secure W2 to provision the profile on it. But hey, isn't MSChap v2 vulnerable? Well, yes, it is. It has in fact been broken for years.
1 minute.
Right. But it is used within PEEP, so that's good. It's inside a TLS session, so it's all good. Next slide, please. How can I get it? Well, you need some things. Basically, you need an access point with enterprise support, need some radius settings, and virtual machine to set up the radius server, user directory, fixed IP address, and some clue. Next slide, please. So these are the
seconds.
Events that using it. Next slide, please. So, yes. These are actually already connected. Next slide, please. Okay, excellent. Want to help? You can contact us. Thank you.
So as you can see, sometimes even 15 minutes is not enough. Felix, are you in the audience? Ready to go? Okay, great. We're just going to jump right into the next talk. Everybody who's coming in through the sides, we still, even now, have plenty of space over on this side of the room. Right now, we are in the 15-minute session. We have 4 15-minute talks, and then we're going to jump right back into 15-minute lightning talks. We are actually going, it's not on the schedule, but we will take a short break between the 15-minute talks and the 5-minute talks, because I do not yet have all of the slides that were promised for the other lightning talks, and we'll fit other things in there as well. So without any further ado, Felix, you ready to go? Are we all settled? Let's let some people come in and out. And if we could have your attention, your 15 minutes starts now.
All right, I would like to talk to you about advanced aerodynamics based on non-divergent fractal fluids models, which means new models based on fractals and not on voxel grid, based on Navier-Stokes equations like they are done now. Next slide, please. So even with supercomputer render power, the most common questions are not understood properly, which is this understanding of lift. So there are three competing theories where you can explain lift. Which the most popular one is Bernoulli, where it say the faster air creates a lower pressure over the top of the wing, and then by this lifts the wing up. And a more modern way is Newton. Some people since 10 years argument about the impulse change and the downwash of air. And also modern discussion is the Martin-William-Kutta condition, which adds a rotation motion over a wing, which deflects the air downwards. Next slide, please. Let's start with the most popular idea of Bernoulli. Bernoulli, you often argument that two particles, one is passing the wing below and the upper passing up above the wing, have to meet again at the end of the wing. And so by this, the upper particle has to pace up, and there's no mechanical reason why should they dance together at the end of the wing. So this is not very a proper explanation, and it's also a bit old-fashioned. Next slide, please. This idea is based on the research of Bernoulli of pressure tubes where there is a small cross-section in between, and therefore, remaining the mass continuum flow, the speed has to go up. And by that acceleration, it's recorded that the measurement shows a lower of static pressure. And so, but next slide, please. It often comes from understanding of mechanics, like when there's a mass on a ramp exposed to gravity field, and the potential high means the potential force, where when the ramp decreases, the potential energy goes converted into speed. And but this only works if you have an external field happening. Next slide, please. If this also creates spontaneous motion in a pressure tube, you would also can say that the tale of Münchhausen would be true, that it can happen spontaneous motion out of nothing, and it would be actually a violation against the Newton's action and reaction principle. Next slide, please. How can we make an evidence of that? That is wrong understanding. Next slide, please. Matter won't change to second law of Newton, its direction if there is not an additional force applied. So that matter streams inside the measuring tube, you have to apply additional force to deflect the pressure in this direction. And therefore, you have to withdraw force, and this is recorded then as a pressure drop. Next slide, please. So also, you can convert the centripetal equation into Bernoulli equation into the centripetal equation very easily, which can show that there there are centripetal forces acting in this measurement. So actually, it can say that what I measure is not real. Next slide, please. It also can be argumented by momentum conservation, where we say on the left side, the forces can only act in a 90-degree angle, and by this inelastic push, there has been energy released, and which goes into turbulence. Right side shows another example of a static condition, where you can see that the forces can apply equally, and so there the forces remain static in the measurement. Next slide, please. And even natural researches on streams show that the pressure level is highly relative to the location in the stream. So due to inertial movement of mass, you don't have equal pressure levels, and only there where the inertial mass allows it to. Next slide, please. So conclusion, we can say that Bernoulli found a direct correlation between speed and measurement, but this does not describe the true fluid mechanics. Next slide, please. According to hydraulic law, you can say that there has to happen equal acceleration force, otherwise you would compensate forces, and so the exceeding force causes the acceleration, and thereby the diameter of the ideal flow body shapes hyperbolically and also decreases by time and speed, and so you have an ideal fluid body inside the stream. And this, to maintain static, the outer parts of the stream are braced by turbulent boundary layer and shearing motion. Next slide, please. When you are now look at the pressure drop, you will recognize that there has been a lack of energy because the potential pressure has decreased after the passing of the cross section, and thereby there must be an explanation where the remaining energy went to, because the speed is at the same level than before passing the cross section. It can be explained very easily that the kinetic energy is trapped inside vortices where the speed remains the same. But in global, the traveling of the whole stream has the old speed. So next slide, please. You can say that this is a classic heterodynamic resistor. Next slide, please. And to understand the statics inside the stream, you can say that there is a trunk in the middle, which is the main stream, the ideal form of the hyperbolic shape, where there are fractal branches split off and brace the other statics and compensate the inequality of forces to remain a mechanical system. Next slide, please. So nature shows us many examples, like cloud motion and stuff like that, where these tree-like architecture or forces are applied, unlike how it's explained in Bernoulli. Next slide, please. And the idea is, for instance, enhancing the 3D Mandelbolger, which is able to create 3D fractals, because normally the fractals are 2D, and into 4D fractals, where you can emerge motion in time and space. And next slide, please. So this algorithm would look for instable moment in the liquid, where there is external information amplified into the matter and tells whether the matter is collapsing into the next stable moment, compared to Navier-Stokes, which is based on grids and just looks for the divergent motion between the voxels, and by that applying a different equation, which is not very accurate because of self-similar features of fractals, you never hit the true shape. Next slide, please. So we can say that even ideas of such people like Rupert Sheldrake, the morphogenic field can all be applied in mathematical evidence, where you can say that the virtual information is amplified in matter, and so you can say that matter is actually an amplifier of virtual information, which is displayed in instable moment of fluid, for instance. And it also explains emergent information, which like sand dunes where there's features. Yeah, okay, next slide, please. So how a lift is created then? Next slide, please. You can say that it's a combination of Newton and vacuum force. Next slide, please, where the inertial mass travels over a convex surface, where normally it would change a direction and there's a vacuum spreading unless there is pressure inside the air, and this pressure potential gets withdrawn and deflects the air back onto the surface. Next slide, please. So the air follows in a certain delay, where in between there is a little pressure bubble because the air is too inert, it cannot turn into the bubble and collapse it. Unless the angle is small enough, but if the angle increases, the air is able to travel along big enough circles to travel inside the pressure bubble and make it collapse by that way, and the pressure gets detached by vortices. Next slide, please. Also, nature shows this on birds when they approach in a steep attack angle on landing maneuvers, for instance, where the feathers lift to inertial effects, but only to a certain distance when they reach the laminar stream. Next slide, please. So how we can apply this technically is like we have a flexible surface of a wing with elements like feathers, which are get shaped into form according to the pressure potential applied at the certain situation. And so in each situation, the form is always getting an ideal shape. Also, when getting in star mode, the elements get ripped off and protecting the pressure bubbles above the elements from collapsing, where the stream only can flow up below the elements. Next slide, please. I created a nice movie which explains a more deeper level of the aerodynamic behavior on airplanes, and also shows nice high speed analysis, and here you can see quite nice how the elements get pulled into the stream to a certain level until they reach the laminar area, and so protect the collapsing of the low pressure bubbles. And okay, next slide. Yeah, I've also publicated an article which is going more deeply into physics and explaining it on certain other effects, and also there's my YouTube user channel and the Facebook page where I mostly update these projects. Can we get to the last slide again? Because there's still some time. To mention, this is the first model which is not that perfect. So this is version 1.0, and I already got some conclusions about this. This how to improve this in a more deeper level, because there are some material issues and also some vortex generation issues which have to be improved.
You have 2 minutes left. We could go watch the video if you like.
Oh yeah. Okay. Just pick maybe the first one, if you can reach it very quickly. Okay, didn't estimate that. Was very much rushing through the issue, and So it's I'm filmed with a GoPro camera, but for this model it was a little bit too heavy, and I only could get nice flights without the camera, because but even with the camera you get nice effects. So this is the first without the elements, and you see the plane gets into stall mode, and then the pressure drops, and then it drops very, very fast. And now the same effect with the elements, and you can see the behavior is very constant and equal. And it's yet just with gliding flights, but I'm working on motor flights. And so this is explaining again a little bit how the mechanics work. We have these elements which get shaped into by the stream, and when you have normal flight modes, they should be layered together. And then if the pressure increases, the air moves them in shape until they reach a critical.
Okay. 30 seconds.
We can maybe speed up a little bit the video for 1 minute. Yeah, like this. Yeah, that's just more important, the scene in action. Yeah, that's okay, that's fine. So you can see the elements are not entirely lifted off, but just in a certain level when they reach the laminar border of the stream. And I have the other videos is more, I'm going more into detail. This is the first video, then the other one is having longer flights and more precise analysis of this flight model.
And so. We're at time. I didn't get a chance to ding your 10 seconds, so we're good. So yeah, that's it. You good? Could you have imagined trying to present all that in 5 minutes? 15 probably wasn't enough. All right, so we're going to keep jumping right into it. We are in the 15-minute portion of the lightning talks. Oh, what? I am? Oh, right, sorry.
Hello.
Good. Okay. And if we're ready to go, we've readjusted in the room. Also, everybody who's back there, if you could remind all the people who might come in during this session, we've never filled that section over there with chairs. So have them go. Keep walking back over there. Just don't go backstage to reach there. And are we ready to go? Okay, we've got another 15-minute session, which starts now.
Nun, ich fange mal mit der ersten deutschen Session heute an. Mein Name ist Leon von Tippeskirch. Ich stelle das vor, was ich mit René Treffer zusammen gemacht habe. Der Name ist wie Kaffee magnetisches, die Elliptic Curve Cryptography auf der BitTorrent DAT. Slide. Für alle, die während dem Talk etwas langweilig ist, können den Source Code jetzt gleich auschecken. Oben sieht man dann weiterhin auch den GitHub-Account für alle, die später reinkommen. Es ist relativ einfach zu starten. Man braucht die OpenSSL-Tools, die normalen Build-Tools und kann sich hier mit einem DAT von der größten, der Kademlia von BitTorrent verbinden. Funktioniert aber genauso mit allen anderen DATs. Slide. Erstmal, was ist ein DAT? DAT. Sehr vereinfacht ausgedrückt, ist wie ein Key-Value-Store. Man hat einen Key, einen Value. Der Key ist der Hash oder an einem Beispiel von großen BitTorrent-Netzwerken, die nach deutschen Parteien benannt sind, Magnet Links. Und dahinter verbirgt sich dann die Liste an Peers, die man kontaktieren muss. Und diese Peers, jeder sucht sich dann zufällig einen dieser Peer-Zahlen raus, das ist 160 Bit und der Magnet-Link ist der SHA-1, deswegen auch die 160 Bit. Und Slide. Man sucht sie sich vorher zufällig aus und dann die, die am nächsten zu dem gewünschten Key sind, wie hier das 2CAFE, routen es dann dorthin. Darüber ist es dann distributed. Hier haben wir die beiden Peers, Peer 1 CAFC und Peer 2 CAFF, die eben die nächsten sind und die das Routing dort weitermachen. Sollte aber jetzt jemand versuchen, 2CAFE nicht mehr erreichbar zu machen, kann er, Slide, eine sogenannte Eclipse-Attack ausführen. Die IDs sind ja vollkommen frei wählbar. Er wählt also zwei, die sehr nahe an der Ziel-ID sind und die jetzt in Rot gezeichnet sind, verschweigen einfach die Existenz von 2CAFE und es ist nicht mehr erreichbar. Slide. Jetzt ist die Frage, wie kann man das nicht komplett verhindern, aber es auf jeden Fall erschweren. Wir sagten vorher, die Peers haben eine zufällige ID. Wenn diese ID nicht mehr zufällig ist, immer noch weiterhin 160 Bit, sondern man einen Key erzeugt für die Public Key Encryption, dann ist es ja nicht einfach, einen zufälligen zu wählen. Wir haben uns dazu entschieden, die Elliptic Curve Cryptography zu nehmen, und zwar mit einer Länge von 176 Bit. Vorne diese ersten 16 Bit werden festgelegt auf 02 CAFE und dann bleiben die restlichen 160 Bit übrig, um dann den Public Key zu erzeugen. Unten sieht man den Vergleich mit einem Algorithmen-Slide. Hier wäre zum Beispiel ein Prozess, wie man das jetzt bisher machen würde. Man würde sich einen Key erzeugen. Das dauert etwas, auf einem aktuellen Rechner ungefähr eine Minute. Es hat einen Hash, der beginnt hier mit 02CAFE, nimmt den letzten Teil, die letzten 160 Bit, announced den normal als seine PID, die vorher frei gewählt war, eröffnet seine DAT und startet seinen Ping und benutzt die DAT wie bisher. Slide. So würde es zum Beispiel aussehen, wenn man mit jemandem spricht, der auch die gleiche Kryptographie benutzt. Man hat Alice und Bob haben ihren Private und Public Key. Alice macht einen Ping, setzt in dem BSON noch die Variable, dass er Encryption spricht. Bob sagt, ja okay, das ist ja ganz nett. Ich encrypte mein Pong mit dem Public Key von Alice, der ja die ID ist, das heißt, er ist vorher bekannt, es gibt keinen vorherigen Handshake. Alice kann diesen Pong encrypten, sagt ja, er kann auf jeden Fall encryption, er spricht dieselbe Version, alles ist gut. Ich, in der weiteren Kommunikation benutze ich einfach Bobs Public Key, der seine Node-ID ist, plus 02CAFE und die weitere Kommunikation kann encrypted stattfinden. Slide. Sollte es so sein, dass Bob noch kein Encryption spricht, wie im Moment 100% der DHT, schickt man den Parameter weiterhin mit. Bob ignoriert ihn, antwortet unencrypted, man hält ihn in seiner normalen Liste für unencrypted Clients und kann weiterhin seine DHT aufbauen. Slide. Sollte Bob aber versuchen, so zu tun, als wäre er encrypted, kann er zwar die Antwort, das Pong, encrypted zurückschicken, weil er hat ja Alice Public Key. Sobald aber Alice dann weiter mit ihm redet, kann er die Daten, die er von Alice bekommt, nicht mehr unencrypten, weil er ja den Private Key zu seiner ID nicht hat. Slide. Die Vorteile gegenüber der normalen DHT und anderen Ideen ist, dass der DHT-Verkehr insgesamt encrypted ist. Das heißt, bis auf den ersten Ping, den könnte man auch encrypten. Im Moment ist es zu dem Punkt der Abwärtskompatibilität einfach ein ganz normaler unencrypteter Ping. Es gibt keinen Handshake und keinen zusätzlichen Roundtrip. Das heißt, der Overhead ist sehr gering, obwohl eine Encryption initiiert wird, weil der Public Key durch die ID eh schon bekannt ist. Die extra Payload pro DHT-Paket ist mit 22 Bytes relativ gering. Es wird eben ein temporärer Key erzeugt. Man sollte hier nicht mit dem Public Key Encryption, den Ephemeral Key. Es ist weiterhin abwärtskompatibel. Das Beispiel, was ich euch vorher gezeigt habe und was man in der Adresse oben rechts auch klonen kann, kann sich ja mit der normalen DHT genauso verbinden, sprich dann halt unencrypted. Der Public Key ist bekannt, das heißt, man hat einen Public Key von einem Host, mit dem man kommunizieren möchte. Das heißt, in oberen Ebenen kann man den weiterverwenden oder zum neuen Handshake verwenden. Und ein weiterer Vorteil davon ist, man kann, was vorher, sie waren frei wählbar, die IDs, konnte man einfach die ID eines anderen annehmen. Man wählt einfach die gleiche ID. Das ist mit Encryption sehr viel schwieriger, da man ja nicht die gleiche ID, den gleichen Private Key dazu hat. Den müsste man ja errechnen. Slide. Wir haben das Ganze auf der DHT-Referenzimplementierung, die auch in Transmission verwendet wird. Transmission ist ein großer BitTorrent-Client, gemacht. Das kann man auch dann relativ einfach in Transmission integrieren. Da fehlt jetzt noch, wenn man es 1:1 übernimmt, ist die Key-Generierung, bevor die UI startet. Also das müsste man, wenn man es einbaut, noch etwas schöner machen, sodass das ganze Programm nicht blockiert. Die Implementierung müsste sich da aber nicht besonders schwer halten. Slide. Hier noch ein paar weitere Informationen. Als verwendete Kurve haben wir die, muss ich nachlesen, C2 PNB 176 Version 1 benutzt. Hier sieht man, dass es 176 Bit breite ist. Damit kommen diese 16 Bit von vorher, der 2KF. Und die restlichen 160 Bit bleiben dann. Den Source sieht man hier nochmal in groß. Zusammengemacht haben, hat das René Treffer hier unten und ich, Leon von Tippskirch. Hier sind noch unsere E-Mail-Adressen und Twitter-Accounts. Und falls irgendjemand noch Fragen hat, kann er sich am besten jetzt schon mal anstellen. Und dann Slide. Jetzt kommt das Ganze, dass man das sagt, wie man das, wo sind die größten Lücken dahinter? Wenn man sagt, einen Key zu erzeugen, dauert eine Minute. Dann, um Keys zu erzeugen, die möglichst nah an der beschriebenen Eclipse-Attack sind, braucht man Keys, die sehr viel näher sind als im Schnitt alle, die in der Kademlia sind. Das sind ungefähr 2 hoch 20 Schlüssel, womit man einen Core 2 Jahre auslasten könnte. Ist an sich nicht besonders viel. Man braucht dann noch ungefähr 10 nahegelegene Schlüssel, das heißt, man ist ungefähr bei 20 Jahren. Das lässt sich oft lösen. Das heißt, man kann, wenn man ein Cluster hat, wenn man ein bisschen Geld auf Amazon wirft, kann man das mit 5.000 bis 10.000 Euro genügend Schlüssel erzeugen, um die Eclipse-Attack wieder zu machen, die vorher ohne Kosten zu erzeugen war. Auf der anderen Seite erzeugt man damit Schlüssel, die eindeutig sind und die danach verbrennen können. Das heißt, wenn der Node weiß, diese Schlüssel sind nicht gutartig, die announcen nicht weiter, verhalten sich nicht gutartig im Netzwerk, können sie geblacklistet werden oder
5 minutes
rausgenommen werden. Und damit eröffnet man eben neue Möglichkeiten, die, wenn die frei wählbar sind, so nicht wären. Und das war es auch schon an größten Dingen von meiner Seite. Anscheinend rede ich zu schnell. Wenn noch irgendwelche Fragen offen sind. Anscheinend nicht.
Felix, did you want to take questions? Yeah, you still have 4 minutes for questions if you'd like. Oh, he did? Okay, sorry. That was an unintentional joke. All right. Those are my favorite, the ones where I don't even know the jokes at my expense. Okay. And which is good, because now we're only 1 minute behind.
Yep.
All good? Okay, your 15 minutes starts now.
Okay, thanks, Nick. All right, I'm going to give a slightly extended talk of our lightning talk of 2 days ago. My name is Ralf. I'm a researcher at Technische Universität München. I just realized, Nick, by the way, this is not the updated version of the slides, but I'm happy to do it with these. Unless you do have the updated version.
We can sort that out if you want.
Sorry.
It's for your protection, not mine. maybe just... Oh, today? Okay. The latest one is from yesterday. Okay, yeah, I'm sorry. Where do you know? Where did you send them?
All right, we'll do it in the old slides then.
Okay. Sorry, I never received them, but your 15 minutes is good now.
Okay, cool. Now, again, researcher, Technische Universität München, blah, blah, blah. I have been told... Yeah, that. I have been told last night that the difference between a researcher and someone who just fiddles around with things is the writing up. I think I agree. Next slide, please. Right. My talk is about our CrossBear tool, which is involved in SSL and SSH. Brief reminder, you have been told these numerous times, I believe. So this is the X509 PKI, which is a hierarchy, and there are two remarkable issues here. One is there are chains of trust. Certificates can be used to certify other entities, which can in turn again certify others. And there's one thing called a root store, which is where your root certificates are stored, like in your Netscape browser, your Chrome browser, your Internet Explorer, if you like to use that, and or in your operating system. And here's one thing, all certification authorities are equal. Some maybe can be said to be more equal than others, but one thing remains, if you break one certification authority, you have broken the whole system of X509 PKI, because any CA can issue for any domain or any entity. Slide, please. Now, have you ever seen this screenshot? Who has? Wow. 50%, why I'm here. Right, this is the DigiNotar incident. This is the screenshot that was sent by a user in Iran, lately in Iran, and this caused the DigiNotar meltdown and DigiNotar to go out of business, a CA that was well hacked, and the compromise cost about 500 certificates, rogue certificates for Mozilla, CIA, Mossad, and all the other nice institutions to be issued. And it was only detected because Google Chrome had so far an undocumented feature, which is pinning. They had hard-coded their own certificate into their browser, and that's how this compromise could be detected. DigiNotar did not speak up of their own. Slide, please. And that got us thinking, what can we do to raise hard data? This is not going to be a talk about strengthening X509. There are other proposals for that. But what we are after is a tool to gather hard data so we can prove there are compromises of CAs or whatever. And we would like to raise reliable data about men in the middle in the wild, answer questions like how often do they occur, where are the attackers located, who are they, if we can guess, or are we actually jumping at shadows and this doesn't happen very often at all. And our idea is to combine two principles, namely the notary principle and trace routing, and then do a centralized analysis. Can I have the next slide, please? Okay, what's a notary principle? You've got the user Alice, who's surfing the web or doing other stuff. Slide. She's now being man in the middle. Here's an evil guy sitting on her first hop. Next slide, please. What Alice can do, however, is if she has a little tool called CrossBear, ours, and she has this SSL secured connection, and with our server certificate hard-coded into her software, she can actually query our own server, what do you see for this given destination slide? And our host is happy to fulfill her every wish and check out this, check out the server and send her back a result slide. Exactly, so you get a report. And now we know there is a mismatch with what they see. Slide, please. So what Alice can do now is to help us out and start a trace route to the destination, slide, and send that as a report to us. And that's now useful because now we have hard data that something is on. Slide, please. So what our server is going to do is it has a list of hunting tasks and it likes to distribute those. You can pull them from the server. And we have a little user called Bob here who can download such a hunting task. Slide. And go hunting. Connect to the server. Try out what certificate it sees, he sees, and do a trace route, and then report. Slide. So we get that. Now what we do need, next slide please, is to have many users. Many, many. Like 100. And what you really see is, have a look at the lower left corner. Every Bob that has a green connection does not see a man in the middle. Every Bob that has a red connection sees a man in the middle. So if you are able to do intersection on the trace route you get, you have an idea where your attacker is located. Next slide, please. It's not quite that easy. There's all kinds of network effects that you have to take into account, and I cannot speak about many of these issues, so there's a research paper for that. But I'll tell you, we also determine some stuff on server side, like we like to know what is the certificate authority that has issued the certificate. Is there a continuity, or has the certificate authority changed? That will trigger a flag in our database. We also like to look up the autonomous systems of the hosts in the trace route, just to see how many autonomous systems occur more often than others. We do geolocation, so geo-IP, find out which countries have been traversed by this traffic. That's kind of interesting, right? And of course, we go after the who is. Now, how can you help us? Our software, what you have seen so far, is available as a Firefox add-on. It's meant for Savvy users, but that's you. And it's not meant for your let's say, less experienced parents, okay? Because they would be confused. But if you know what to do and you know how to interpret what you see, that's quite good. So you get a result from the Crosspair server that it does include all kinds of meta information about the connection. See the code on GitHub for that. Next slide, please. Now, the two attacker kinds that we are after. I'm only going to show you the attackers for which our concept works well. There are two more attackers for which it does not work too well. But yeah, that's all in the paper. Here's the attacker. It's a non-selective attacker, so that he's going to man in the middle everyone. And in this case, he sits on the access point to which Alice is connected. Next slide. And we're also looking at state-level attackers. These are the guys who sit on border routers, inspecting traffic leaving the country. Next slide, please. And for our concept, it's important to note that detection is easy, right? All you need is one report, and then you have detected a man-in-the-middle attack and reported it. And all the attacker can do at this point is drop the connections to the Crosspair server, at which point our tool will actually attempt to send an email to us about this little fact. Localization is a lot harder. You could, of course, say, what you essentially need is at least one trace route from the victim and another one from unpoisoned hunter. The more, the better. The closer to the intersection point, the better, but the success depends on the numbers of hunters. And you can give an estimate, actually, about that. Next slide, please. So here's the curve. What you see is, as long, look at the black curve on the top, what you see is 100 hunters are enough, globally distributed, are enough to have a very high success ratio to find the autonomous system where the attack is happening. But on the router level, it's pretty helpless. But that's okay for us, but we are more interested in the autonomous system, or if you can get it, the access point, right? Okay, next please. Now, a completely different protocol is SSH, but it came to us as a little side project because we did a lot of SSH scans in the past 3 months. So sorry if we hit your SSH server, it's going to happen again. So have you ever wanted to compare an SSH fingerprint in your when you connected to a new rented host maybe, and you didn't have a second channel and you had no idea what the correct host key should be. Do you know many hosters who give you the host key fingerprint when you rent a server? I don't think there's many. There used to be a tool that was called Perspectives that proposed to do this for SSH, but it's not maintained anymore. So we thought, why not use our IPv4 wide scans plus our notary principle that we have already implemented for SSL and do a notary for SSH as well. And that's the domain name cbssh.net in tum.de. Next slide, please. So we have a proof of concept implementation, which is already on GitHub, but which we have not, we don't run it live for users at the moment because we do know that there are security issues with our software. So we don't want you to tamper with it right now, although we are happy about bug reports, of course. So there's a patch for OpenSSH. You can use this new option, verify host key notary, and then you just give it a domain name, and it will use our notary to connect to your server, get the fingerprint, and report it back to you, and warn you on a mismatch, of course. We still have to implement the trace routing because that's a lot more difficult for OpenSSH than it is to do for a Firefox add-on. So if you don't want to use our own notary, however, set up your own. It's all GPL. Next slide, please. And from our IPv4 scans, we can give you this. We have stored our results, all the fingerprints and how often we have seen them. So just use a normal tool like dig and query the TXT record of your IP and put that as a subdomain under our own domain. So for example, for this IP address, you get the fingerprint and that we have seen it for the first time on the 10th of September 2012. But we have seen it twice since then, right? I have used this during the Congress to find out my own fingerprint, which was useful to me. Right, next slide, please.
5 minutes.
Yeah, thanks. Scanning SSH is interesting, especially if you do it worldwide. And I would like to give you a brief background on how you can do it and live. So slide, very important, get your own autonomous system. Slide, because right, your ISP is going to hate you if you try to do billions of connections, but if you have your own autonomous system, and we do, that's a lot easier. Slide? Yeah, that's important too. Have chocolate ready. Have chocolate ready for your administrator because he will hate you too, because he will get the reports that you are causing. Last time we had about 80,000 reports sent to the Internet Storm Center, which is good. I mean, 3.5 billion connections and only 80,000 reports. That's pretty good, I think. Don't do stateful tracking on your firewall, or be prepared to see your routers die. Our autonomous system is kind of offline at the moment because we scanned. Sorry to our admin at this point. Be prepared to get many complaints by mail. Write to certs, next please. Write to blacklist so they whitelist you. And tap twice, please. You can scan in 5 days with just one strong server. And yeah, you're going to make a lot of new friends because for yeah, you do. Can you go to the next slide, please? These are new friends. And I mean this. These guys are relaxed. Tap, please. That's a reply. When I wrote them back, they said, no problem. Feel thanked for the reply. That's how relaxed these guys are. Actually, can you? Yeah. Most reports we get are from academic institutions. They seem to be a bit touchy. But if you offer to blacklist them, they say, oh no, not necessary, really. And we had only 10 reports in 3 scans over the months, only 10 occasions where people wanted to be blacklisted, and 50% of them were from private person. In one instance, one guy had rented a virtual server and was really touchy about having received 20 packets from us. I found his Facebook and Twitter account. Slide. So our position here, guys, we do not advertise our tool as a silver bullet. Certainly not. There's lots of stuff, and network effects are really hard to get up with, and the attacker can cope. It's really an arms race here, and we are in the unlucky position that we have to come up with something new as soon as the attackers adapt to our methods. We do believe that we can get good results against one type of attacker, the non-selective attackers, but these are also the ones we're interested in. And we're more or less deployed and ready. We have used we have standalone hunters on Planet Lab, and in our beta phase this year we had about 4,000 certificate reports, but no man in the middle found. Slide, please. So, what's next? I'm very grateful we have received a grant to implement Crosspair for the Open Observatory of Network Interference, a TOR sub-project, which hopefully should get us many clients plus people in the right locations understanding what they do. And that is where all our efforts will go in the next few months. And we, of course, have to do a lot of automatic analysis. So, slide, please. That's us. We are on Twitter. We are on the World Wide Web, but we're also on GitHub. So check out our software. Write emails to us. We do know that the software is not complete. We're working on it, still working on it, and we do hope to have some good results very soon. I see I've got about 1 minute left, so I'm happy to take any questions. But that's all for me. Thanks.
I'll stop the clock, but wait for the audio angel to get over to you so you can ask your question on the microphone. And for those of you exiting, try to let our wonderful audio angel through.
Are you collaborating your results with the EFF ESSL Observatory?
I didn't get it. Can you say it again, please?
Are you correlating results with the EFF ESSL Observatory?
Kind of. I have copies of the EFF. So the question was, do I correlate my results with the EFF Observatory? I do not correlate results on man-in-the-middle reports because, as far as I know, that data is still within the EFF and not public. I do have their scans, and we do have one large analysis server where we do correlate results between our own scans and theirs. So that's half a yes and half a no. But I'm happy to do it as soon as that data gets public.
Do you have currently a method to detect wrong reports, for example, if the attacker uses your tool to report many wrong sites, or if the attacker sees that your tool detected him, he wanted to give misleading information, so you think he will be somewhere else?
Okay, wonderful question, thanks. The question is, do we have any measures to mitigate an attacker who's trying to send us fake reports? That's a difficult question. One short answer is, we have one little trick. We force anyone who wants to report to do a full TCP handshake with us, citing a token that our server knows. So you cannot spoof an IP address arbitrarily. You have to have control over the system or any system downstream. That forces the attacker to limit himself to a system he controls. What we cannot do is cope with attackers who are trying to send, if they can spoof the IP address, reports from that. That's analysis. We need to do clustering here and find out if there's a suspicious number of reports coming from certain systems or from certain paths. We do have BGP data. We know plausible traces. We know plausible paths in the internet, so we can check that. That's a lot of hard work, and it does become manual work. Okay? So yes, there are some measures in place, but well, it's the internet. They can never be complete, and the attacker is always one step ahead of us. If he really wants to drop our connections, he can do so. We have thought about fallback to email and fax.
And that's your time. Warm round of applause.
Thanks.
And then, Matt, I saw you walk in. And if I could just quickly get you to come over here. I've been holding on to this for you since tour camp, and I thought now I should finally get rid of it so I don't get harassed by security for it on the way back.
You're pretending that I can take this on a plane.
Well, it's your problem now.
I brought toys.
Although if it makes you feel any better, I managed to fly here with that.
Yeah.
So you should be okay. All right, you almost ready to go?
Yeah, just one more thing.
Are you going to be holding those up? Should we prepare the cameras to look for
those?
Yeah,
I'm going to be holding those up in a bit.
Okay.
All right. Look. Stuff. Things.
Good morning, hackers.
I consider it okay that my talk is going to be punctuated by the sound of dropped bottles. It's just a fact of the matter.
Matt, could you hold up one of the things you're going to be holding up so they can just try to get make an attempt at getting a close up of it? Is that the best camera position you can get for holding his? I guess that's about as good as we're going to get. So are you ready to proceed?
Yeah.
Okay, go.
Ruby. So I'm Matthew Borghetti. I wear a bunch of different hats. One of them is industrial designer, worked on a whole bunch of projects doing different kind of industrial materials design for places like Fusion Brands, which make a lot of silicone bakeware. I used to work in the special effects industry, which had me playing with a lot of animatronics and a lot of material science. And I recently started doing stuff with universities and robotics projects and thought that I could bring something interesting to the field of robotics, including opening the source and opening the methods on soft robotics. Completely pneumatic, or doesn't have to be pneumatic, but my designs are pneumatic, no hard parts required, cast silicone robots that are powered by air. Slide. So here's kind of the state of the art right now. The Whitesides Group has this thing that you might have seen before. It's a DARPA-funded project that is a little kind of walking crab starfish design. A cast silicone object with another silicone sheet adhered to the top of it that has a bunch of channels running through it that cause it to inflate. And this is actually another project from the Whitesides lab slapped on top of it. That's a microfluidics project, so it's essentially a robot sandwich. And on the upper right, you have a robot from, I think, about 10 years ago. The Tufts ATL lab designed this caterpillar. The caterpillar is actually controlled by nitinol wire, so there are hard, incredibly hot wires inside of this. And the robot you see on the bottom is done by Festo Labs, which does a lot of pretty and innovative robotics, but this thing is also controlled by a number of hard cables. These are kind of inflexible skeletal elements that are at the core of a lot of these robots, and I think limit them in terms of their softness, organicness, and mimicry of nature. Next. So, what the heck is a soft robot good for? This is a project from the Mediated Matter Lab at MIT. These are printed cuffs for alleviating carpal tunnel. Everybody's hands are a bit different, everybody's carpal tunnel is a bit different, and a lot of the therapies for carpal tunnel involve limiting your axes of motion on the hand and also reducing the pressure to your wrists. But the idea is that with an individual person's flexibility, with an individual person's range of motion, their pain points, you can actually design something backwards from those specifications to design a brace that works for them. And the kind of things I'm thinking about is there are people who have strokes. They actually have these assistive devices in therapy to get them, to encourage them to use the damaged arm. So oftentimes in a stroke, you'll have damage to a part of the motor cortex and the somatosensory cortex, and you'll end up having somebody whose arm doesn't work the way they want it to. And one of the therapies for this is to actually attach robotic controls to their arm to give them that last little bit of oomph, because if they don't use the damaged limb, they actually don't regrow a pattern of neurons to move around the damaged areas. It can be done. Neuroplasticity lasts your whole life. But it takes very, very diligent therapy. And I'm thinking, well, why not a soft wearable cuff that you could inflate to give that level of robotic control that you could wear under any clothing without motors, without batteries? So those are the kinds of things I'm thinking of. Next. So where the heck are the soft robots in the market? Why isn't there a soft robot you can buy? And my particular analysis on this, my take on this, is that the prototyping methods haven't gotten good enough that we can come up with reliable, cheap, iterative designs where we can start with some experiments in the lab and move on to something that essentially predicts its own methods. In industrial design, you have this where you 3D print your models, you 3D print your cell phones, and you test out the interface, you test little designs, you say, this isn't very good in my hand, this doesn't last very long if I drop it. And you can iteratively design that way. Soft robots in the lab right now are very, very time consuming and very, very expensive. And I'm trying to reduce that. Next. So I want to get, here are kind of my main points that I'm trying to solve with this project. I've got a lot of other things I'm trying to play with, but these are like the big brushstrokes. I want to find a generalized method that, with the same techniques, you can make a whole lot of different robots. I want to get arbitrary geometry inside a seamless skin. Essentially, a seamless skin, no seams, no place for the human error to come into play and wreck things. I want to get arbitrary geometry, as in, if I need a robot that's like a tentacle and it has a right-hand curve somewhere in the middle of it, I can actually design the geometry inside of that around the needs, not have the limitations of the fabrication method limit the kinds of robots I can have. So I want the prototyping to be inexpensive. I want them quick and variable so that I can easily change different designs on the fly. And I want them easy to reproduce. I want that if I have a successful looking design, I can make a whole bunch of them to put them through trials. Because a good robot stands up to a lot of environments. And this is one of my core beliefs at the bottom here. This is one of my core beliefs about universities. Grad student labor is slave labor and cannot be reproduced in the market. If your thing takes 100 grad student hours to put together, it's probably not a marketable product. Next. So here's what I'm doing. I'm working with a company called Viridis that's doing my 3D printing. Viridis was founded by Jim Brett, who is one of the core founders of Z-Corp, which is a 3D powder printing company. And what I'm doing is I'm making 3D powder printed molds that involve soluble cores. So the outside of the robot mold is made of plastic. The inside of the robot mold is made of wax or a soluble material like cornstarch. I'm using parametric CAD to do this, so that I can change variables. When something doesn't work, I can roll back in the method and be like, this needs to be more densely filled, or the wall thickness needs to change. So I can quickly change my designs to fit my needs. And then I'm trying to have it be minimal manual fabrication. I have robots. I have robots that print things for me. Why would I design things that still take up my human time? I can have robots do that for me. Next. So. This is a functioning robotic tentacle. So what happens here is, so there's a structured hollow volume inside of here that as I pump it up, the volume deforms because of the air pressure. So there's a manifold right down the middle and one of these on either side. Bloop. This is a similar model, not hooked up to pneumatic control, but it's a trefoil, three of those volumes on the inside. It should be able to do a full 360. I just got this out of the mold right before CCC, so I haven't had a chance to test this one yet. But I'm sorry too. Next slide. So here's the method for the conical tentacle. So we start out with a hard printed outer mold. This is made of a material called maker dust. This is a material engineered by Jim Brett for Viridis, but it prints out on a regular Z-Corp printer. Additionally, the Z-Corp printer doesn't need any special adhesives or anything for this, and Z-Corps are powered by a standard HP inkjet head. Just in case you were wondering about how magical the 3D printing is, they squirt liquid out of a inkjet head. That's the magic. So next. So here's the core. Here's the cornstarch core I was talking about, printed cornstarch. It's not a terribly complicated material. It is a little bit on the fragile end. It is a little bit on the brittle end. We've moved away from this particular method. It was really, really plausible because the idea was, well, all you have to do is soak the tentacle in water and eventually you have working skin. That doesn't work so very well because you get to something I like to call the lumpy pancake problem, which is you have a little bit of the silicone soak into the cornstarch, and it doesn't quite become silicone, and it doesn't quite stay cornstarch. It becomes, like, if you've ever had a lumpy pancake, you have like a layer of goo on the outside, and then there's like a dry flour lump on the inside. That's what happens. Next one. So here is one, the core placed inside of the shell and silicone being cast in the seam between them, and that's as complicated as it gets. That's just my time assembling this project was just waxing the two sides of the plastic mold and then putting in the core and the silicone. It's a very, very rapid iteration process. Next slide. So here's that experiment working. Next slide. So what went wrong with that one? Well, So the materials design is actually really important with this. The kind of silicone that you choose is actually very important. I started out using a silicone that I just had on hand because I had it on hand. I do a lot of prototyping for companies at my own company, Sleek and Destroy. And I have a lot of silicones on hand. That's just part of my gig. And so I used a cheap one that doesn't have the kind of stretch, that doesn't have the kind of elasticity that I needed. But there are solutions for this. The world is full of silicones. So I already talked about the lumpy pancake thing. The wall thickness, it was important to come up with a method where I could guarantee that the cores I had lined up in the mold so that they wouldn't deviate and change the wall thickness, because when you change the wall thickness on these robots, they actually change the way they move, because the wall thickness is part of the pneumatic actuator. And adhesives were important. I actually found a thing called Silpoxy that ended up working perfectly to seal silicone to silicone. Next. So yes, we made some improvements, we made some changes. Moldmax and Dragonskin, those are the two silicones provided by SmoothOn, smooth-on.com, that work marvelously for this process. Next.
5 minutes.
Yay. So here is the new method, is a wax core. Next slide. So here's Jim Brett pouring up a new tentacle. Next slide. And here's that coming out of the mold. So wax, the wax is easy to produce. It's easy to find. It's easy to manufacture little flat waxes because we're using 3D printed molding. And so all that happens is we cast the silicone in and melt the wax out. Next slide. OK, more complicated things. This thing right here. So more complicated stuff. This. Yeah. So what do we got? Is an outer mold here that's actually three copies of the exact same part, and then the inner core is made, almost lost it, made with this flat mold. These things, although it looks kind of complicated, these things are really easy to produce, because if I design the tentacle that I want, I can roll back the method and print on the 3D printer all the stuff to make it too. This is a mold to create the cores. Next, could I have the next slide? So that's a 3D printed mold that makes this thing. Next slide. So it makes this. Next slide. I cast wax in it. Next slide. And it gets me a core. Next slide. I assemble that. Next slide. With a little jig that I made laser cut. Next slide. And I put it in the mold. All of this stuff I can make easy multiples of. So if I want to have 100 tentacles casting at the same time, say I need 100 legs for something, it's actually really easy for me to just go along the line and pour into all of these molds and have the printer printing more as I'm doing it. Next slide. And so that's what comes out. Next slide. So there's the bottom. You can see the trefoil shape and the little shadows of the way it was cast. Next slide. So what's next? Next slide. Well, I've got a quadruped that's coming out that should be done by the end of January. It should walk with only two airlines, as in one airline causes it to do a left-hand walk and one does a right-hand walk, essentially how a gecko walks up the walls, touching each side of its feet together. So you have left side walk, right side walk. Next slide. So I need your help to push it further. Because I do the mechanical engineering, I do the industrial design, but I think to make it truly open source, because the idea is to get other people doing this, not to just be like, I have a lab and 3D printers, everybody look at me. The whole point is actually to create a better ecosystem for soft robots, because I think they're a really cool technology that needs to be pushed further, and one person in a lab probably isn't going to do it. It's going to be a lot of people playing with a lot of experiments. So I need to bring it to a prototyping level where you don't have to have my specific experience in CAD to use my files and learn from my designs. You know, I've been using like SolidWorks for 10 years. I know SolidWorks pretty well. I shouldn't say, here, use my files, but first, go to design school, drop out of design school, go back to design school, then start working for a special effects industry. That shouldn't be the limitation here. So, fast iteration speed, and I need a computational solution. Next slide. I think that you need that to keep this source open. I can give you my STLs, you can print those on your own, you can print my 3D files, but that's kind of limited. I would rather, I mean, I'm going to give out my 3D files. I have a profile on Thingiverse. My username is GiantEye. I need to document all the things I've been putting up on it, but there are Thingiverse files. Keeping it open is more having you be able to replicate my success, not replicate my specific results. Next slide. OpenSCAD is not an option. So if you do an image search on OpenSCAD, people have been suggesting OpenSCAD, it doesn't have the kind of robust parametric control that I think I need. Next slide. Libraries and processing, like the work of Nervous System and Marius Watts, they have been able to use computational. Thank you. They've been able to use computational design to develop growth patterns that fit certain constraints. And I think that a hollow tentacle populated by a growth pattern that fits certain constraints is perfect. I think what you would end up looking for is like bone ingrafation. Ingrafation? There's a name for it. The patterns inside of bones or the patterns inside of corals, those are algorithmic-based growth patterns. The cells individually are
doing. 30 seconds.
Yes. Next. So, I'm not alone in this process. I'd like to thank Jim Brett and Veritas 3D for helping me out with the engineering and partially funding this project, and Amanda Wozniak for offering amazing advice. So, next. I'm Matthew Bugatti. My site is Harms, and my Twitter handle is GiantEye. Look at my site for all the source and the methods on the robots, and thank you very much. If you want to see these in person, I'll be in the hardware hacking area.
All right. Check. That was the 15-minute round. Thank you again to all the presenters. And we're running 5 minutes behind. I think we might be missing one presentation. But we're just going to go ahead and launch into the regular 5-minute lightning talks now. So just a couple of reminders for people who are giving 5-minute lightning talks. Don't forget to always talk into the microphone, because if you wander away from it a little bit, then people don't really understand what you're saying, and especially the people on the streams will have no idea at all what you're saying. I think we're going to just say no questions and answers for the 5-minute lightning talk round, since we're running behind. So even if you finish early, that's good. Thank you so much. Quick round of applause for the audio angel who is managing that chaos. And are you good?
Yeah.
5 minutes starts now.
Okay. I will be holding up books, so maybe you can focus the camera on me, because I don't have slides. Yeah, my name is Dem_Fred, and my topic is the relation between intellectual property right and science fiction. I want to share a few thoughts, and maybe you're interested to contribute. My contact is in the wiki, or message me on Twitter. So now a really fast lecture. As my lame pun in the background tells, intellectual property right never played a famous role in older science fiction. Knowledge was always free. The main conflicts are of a different kind. But as IPR became a problem in the present, authors became aware and started to think of it as a thing suitable for their own stories. My starting point is the obvious one. In 1984, William Gibson published The Neuromancer, a novel famous for many things. For one, it was there where the term cyberspace was invented, Gibson being the only one who can still use it without irony. Also some of the best contemporary English prose. Besides this, it is in the exposition where intellectual property rights suddenly appears. Knowledge is given to an illegal clinic by an AI named Wintermute. Yes, we have passed the singularity now, which leads to application of patents and some people become incredibly rich. Everything okay. The next one, a classic too. In 1995, Neal Stephenson published The Diamond Age, a novel about the past, namely the Victorian Age, becoming a part of a future in which nanotechnology is dominating, making everything easily reproducible, just like we hope it would come. But there's blood in the water. There's a low class of outcasts who can only replicate the basic goods to survive, everything else being copyrighted and protected through IPR. And so it begins. 2005, Paolo Bacigalupi publishes a series of short stories in a collection named PAM6, featuring a world which is devastated through engineered diseases and famines which were produced by global companies to create food monopoles. These companies sell plant seeds to a starving humanity which lacks the ability to produce new seeds and are protected by IPR. Do you see who was the role model for this? Monsanto. In 2009, Bacigalupi publishes The Wind-Up Girl with the terrible German title Biokrieg, which continues this universe. 2009, Cory Doctorow, which we all know, publishes his novel Makers under CC license, free to download, just so you know. It is dedicated, and I want to quote it here, for the risk takers, the doers, the makers of things. It features a near future in which a large corporation, Kodakfa, struggles to survive and relies on a new business model featuring you, the makers. It is a world where fabbers, 3D printers are common technology and most everyday goods can be fabbed, including AK-47s, but not yet the bullets. What was it a few weeks ago? Someone fired 6 shots from a fabbed gun? Foreshadowing anyone? And now the last one, which I unfortunately don't have here, it's Michael Scalzi's Old Man's War. Once again, a terrible German title, Krieg der Klone. Why can't we get this right? It is set to be the new Starship Troopers, and it features a future in which humanity is in a deadlock conflict with all other species in the galaxy, a war fought by old people, their consciousness put into new enhanced military bodies, making them relatively immortal. But once they have done their military duty, they need to give these bodies away because the technology is protected as intellectual property of the military of mankind. Oh, the pains. So what's the point? Many of these novels won awards, including Hugo and Nebula, not only because these books are good entertaining sci-fi literature, which I wanted to share with you, but because the authors care to not only make their invented futures believable, but a plausible continuation of the ideas that are already part of our world. What's my message? All these novels feature concepts of intellectual property rights similar to already existent ones, and like in the present, they make the future much more boring than it should be. Science fiction, and I need to repeat this again, is not meant as an instruction manual. It is the exploration of future possibilities, and sometimes it is meant as a warning. Intellectual property right has to change. We have to force it. 3D printing has to stay free. Science fiction will get even more awesome. Thank you.
All good? Okay, we're running a little bit behind, so we're just going to jump right into it. Your 5 minutes starts now.
Good morning. My name is David Fifield. I am a member of the Tor project, and I'm the primary developer of the Flash Proxy Censorship Circumvention System.
And my name is Brian Dugan. I work at the Open Technology Institute in Washington, D.C., and I am a recent Flash Proxy volunteer.
So... first of all, about the name, we do not use Adobe Flash. we actually use JavaScript, and I'll explain kind of how the whole system works, and then Brian will tell you some more about a special system using Flash Proxy. So the problem we're trying to solve is internet censorship. In a lot of countries, people want access to Tor in order to read the free internet. But the problem is, in a lot of countries, access to Tor relays is blocked by IP address. How do we get around this? Well, our solution is to use a network of miniature temporary proxies that run in web browsers as a JavaScript program. There are some limitations with writing network applications inside of a browser. Namely, when you're using WebSocket, you can't listen for connections as you would with a normal proxy. So instead, we invert the usual proxy model. We have the proxy connect to the client. That imposes some difficulties, but I'll explain how that works. Next slide, please. First of all, the client has to advertise its willingness to the outside world to receive a connection. I'm a censored client. Please come help me. Now, this step is a bit tricky. You see here, this is a message going through the firewall. So clearly, this can't just be a direct, straightforward connection. This problem is tricky, but not impossible to solve. And we actually have an implementation of this process happening. If you want to talk to me afterward, I can explain how we make this work. Next slide, please. At this point, a Flash proxy comes online. What this means is they open up a web browser to a web page that has this JavaScript programming, this program running on it. The Flash proxy asks the facilitator, which is a network of database of client addresses, do you have any censored clients to give to me? Slide, please. The facilitator says, yes, here is your client. Slide, please. At this point, the flash proxy makes a connection to the censored client. Now, this is another line that's going through the firewall. The reason we believe this line is less likely to be blocked is that this is a random web browser. This connection is coming from a random IP address, which is not going to be on any censored, on any censor's blacklist. Next slide, please. And finally, the proxy makes a connection to a Tor relay and simply starts copying bytes back and forth. And you're on Tor.
So there are a few issues with some of the resources available on the screen. So the most limited resource is the flash proxy itself. Right now, there are maybe 5 websites in the entire world that actually host the flash proxy JavaScript, and there are maybe as many users, I think last check was 57 users, who actually have visited those websites and keep their tab open and perform as relays for the clients. So how can we maximize the popularity of running a flash proxy? We could use platforms that are already popular and build in the flash proxy, for example, into a Facebook application. So what if we had a Facebook application that could make it available to Facebook users? What could we do with that? We could have a persistent store of the number of bits that you've proxied from the client to the Tor network. You could rank and rate users against each other and make it a social experience, for better or worse. But I think that the social intervention here is exploiting the most privacy invasive network on the face of the planet to provide privacy and anonymity to people who actually need it. So not only does it make the experience social, but it can also be an activist platform, providing we could push out news events and updates about the state of privacy in the world to people who are actively giving up their privacy on Facebook every single day. This is a project that we're looking to start right now. Both David and I need volunteers for the Facebook application and for Flash Proxy proper. So if you are a Facebook developer, JavaScript developer, we would both love to talk to you. So very excited, and thank you very much.
You bet. Slide. Be excellent to one another.
Should I start?
Actually, I didn't get the latest version, so do you want to try plugging in your...
You don't have the latest version?
I summon you. I said.
Everyone knows my number. So, okay, guys.
good to start with some entertainment, right?
Okay, your 5 minutes starts now.
Okay. My name is Helge Stettler. I'm from the Assembly of OpenStreetMap, and I want to tell you today something about OpenCMap, which is about navigation on the sea, and especially OpenCMap AR. We have an OpenCMap app right now on the App Store, which looks like this, which is for iPhone and iPod. And please have a look at this small images. So pretty small signs of navigation, for example, lighthouses. Just keep that in mind. We also have an iPad app for that, and which just gives you more space. And it's pretty successful, though it's ranking on place 100 and something. We started last January with providing the app to the public. Until now, we had roughly 20,000 downloads, and it was mentioned in several publications. And we have by now 100 downloads per day. This is the downloads over since we started with the application. And as you see, it's roughly 3,000 in a month. The green area is basically where people are boating on the sea, and in the red area, it's not good to have your boat in the sea because it's winter. So during the season is actually the relevant time where you use that. There were some problems with this app because, as I have shown you, these very small signs for navigation are not really practical if you're navigating and if you have to orient yourself quickly on the boat. You have different lighting conditions and everything goes like this, and it's difficult to see them and recognize them. So, and also you have to have all these graphics data as tiles to download up front before you go to the sea because you do not have any internet there. So I imagine something like perhaps augmented reality thing, which helps you orient yourself much quicker. And if you have good weather, that's no problem usually. But if you have bad weather and bad sight, it quickly becomes a problem that you do not know where you are. So if you're, for example, in a foggy situation, then you do not recognize anything and you can see only 20 meters. So why not use the smartphone you carry with you? You have a compass, a gyroscope, you have GPS, and you have, in best case, a database carrying a lot of information about all the CMark sites. Yeah, just turn on your superpower. And CMark site with augmented reality might come in handy here. Just a quick comparison. For example, Superman has X-ray vision. You can just realize that. You have the CMark database from OpenStreetMap. You have GPS, and you have a camera. You can just project it into it. And then you can see through the fog. You have heat vision. You can use the database for weather and combine that with your map. You have even zoom and every other stuff. OK, we fail on solar eye laser, but I think that's OK. Kind of peaceful use. What's next? Yeah, basically you usually orient yourself to this stuff, but you cannot easily recognize that. Even if it's day, it's difficult to recognize because it's usually far away. And it's good to stay far away from that because it's secure then. And if it's foggy, you do not see anything of that. So that's a problem. Why not turn that into this? For example, display symbols for these items on a screen. And that's what I want to show you here, this kind of mock-up prototype, how that might look like. So you see the landmarks just on the display and projected into the camera view as augmentation. Yeah, you can see, for example, the lighthouse then, and which is very important because you have to stay away from lighthouses. They are usually on the land, and you do not want to go on the land. And you usually need the red and the green buoys to find, for example, the entrance to a harbor. And yeah, you usually also do not want to go onto land with your boat. So that's basically something I want to do. Also displaying the distance you have to a certain stuff. And yeah, what does it now do? It does not need the clumsy map files, which also lose all semantic information. You do not need all that data. You just download once the XML data from the OpenStreetMap database and use your GPS compass, what you have on your smartphone.
30 seconds.
Yes. And this is something I want to build. So it's an augmented reality renderer, a small engine on the mobile phone, which just uses the XML data from the OpenStreetMap database or the CMark data and projects that stuff. So if you want to help code, just contact me. I'm also known as Trailblazer. And yeah. And I will change my number code now.
Okay, we have a, I think we, if we can just take a quick 5 minute break so I can catch up with all of the presenters that are coming up next. If you have a presentation and you have not yet submitted your slides or you need to talk to me about something, please come up. Other than that, we'll see you back in 5 minutes.
Das hat er noch nicht mal gesehen. Thank you.
Okay, and we are back. Not quite as smooth as yesterday, but that's one of the reasons why we try to run all the slides off a common laptop so we can just go boom, 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 boom. And without any further ado, are you ready?
Yeah.
5 minutes starts now.
Ich heiße euch herzlich willkommen zu meinem Lightning Talk. Wie ihr schon mitbekommen habt, der Vortrag ist in Deutsch. Mein Vortrag halt geht über die Auswirkungen der morphogenetischen Felder auf die elektronische Umgebung. Dieser Begriff morphogenisches Feld ist in den 80er Jahren entstanden durch den britischen Biologen Rupert Sheldrake, der damals ein Gedankenmodell aufgestellt hat, wo es darum geht, dass Wissen, Information in ein Feld gesammelt wird. Er hat es an verschiedenen Beobachtungen damals angefangen, wissenschaftlich zu erarbeiten. Die Hypothese von ihm wurde aber noch in der jetzigen Wissenschaft noch nicht anerkannt. Aber es gibt zum Beispiel das bekannteste Phänomen dieser morphischen Felder kommt aus Großbritannien, wo die Milch, wo die Milchflaschen mit einem Aluminiumdeckel vor dem Zweiten Weltkrieg ausgeliefert wurden. Und eine bestimmte Blaumeisenart hatte damals eine Technik entwickelt, um diese Deckeln zu öffnen, um an die Milch heranzukommen. Während des Zweiten Weltkrieges dann wurden die Milch wieder anders verpackt in Plastiktüten. Nach dem Zweiten Weltkrieg stieg man wieder von der Produktion um auf diese Milchflaschen mit Aluminiumdeckel. Und das Interessante, was beobachtet wurde, ist, dass in ganz Großbritannien alle Meisen in kürzester Zeit diese gleiche Technik wieder anwandten, um an diese Milch heranzukommen. Und bekannt ist in der Wissenschaft, dass diese Meisen zum Beispiel nur einen ganz kleinen Radius haben an Aktionsreichweite, wo sie hin können. Somit war es unmöglich, dass dieses Wissen durch die Zeit, die vergangen ist, unmöglich, diesen Meisen direkt beizubringen. Also musste irgendetwas da sein, dass dieses Wissen den Meisen danach vermittelt wurde. Um damit mal auf einen Schritt weiter zu gehen in unsere Richtung, wo ich hin möchte, auf die elektronische Umgebung. Also es muss anscheinend irgendein Feld oder ein Wissensfeld da sein, was in der Wissenschaft schon seit mehreren Jahren diskutiert wird und erforscht wird, wo es darum geht, dass sich eine Information, ein Gedanke verbreiten kann. Und wenn ich das jetzt in unseren Raum hier umlege, dann ist es eine Art Information, die entsteht, eine Art Möglichkeit, die einen Raum gibt für spezielles Wissen. Wie vielleicht manche von euch mitbekommen haben, ist das Erlangen von Wissen eine Fähigkeit oder eine Prozedur, wo es immer darum geht, Wiederholungen zu machen, bis man das sich eingeleibt hat. Aber auch gewisse Fähigkeiten, wie zum Beispiel, wie es wir haben mit der Zuckerwatte, diese Zuckerwatte auf diesen Stab draufzubringen, erfordert eine gewisse Art von Geschicklichkeit. Und ich gehe davon jetzt mal aus, dass es sich hier in diesem Kongress ein Feld gebildet hat. In diesem Feld drinnen sammeln sich sozusagen Informationen darüber, über die verschiedenen Techniken, über Fähigkeiten wie Zuckerwatte zu erstellen oder auch ganz banal die Möglichkeit, einen Raum zu geben, um einfach nochmal ein Kind zu sein, so wie es sich gestern ereignet hat, wo die diesen Bällebad, diese Kunststoffbällebad, gestern sehr spontan sich ein Spiel entwickelt hat, wo man sich halt gegenseitig abschießt, aber es war sehr faszinierend zu beobachten, weil das, ohne dass es jemand mitgeteilt wurde, dort Leute angezogen worden, die einfach mitgemacht haben, ohne dass man sich davor überzeugt hatte.
One
einfach,
minute.
Weil dieses Feld einfach da war und diese Möglichkeit da war, dort mitzumachen. Gut, was kann man jetzt machen in der elektronischen Umgebung? Ich gehe davon aus, dass jetzt in dieses Wissensfeld, das auch damit drinnen verankert ist, dass ich daran glaube, dass ich daran weiß, wie der Computer funktioniert. Anhand dessen, dass ich das weiß, funktioniert dieser Computer genau nach meinen Richtlinien. Für Leute, die dieses Feld nicht beiwohnen,
30 Seconds.
Funktioniert dieser Computer vielleicht auch teilweise schlechter oder hat mehrere Bugs. Und meine Forschung, sagen wir so, vorsichtig sagen möchte, oder meine Beobachtung geht in diese Hinsicht. Wie stark beeinflusst unser eigenes Wissen, unser eigenes Feld, die elektronische Umgebung? Vielen Dank für eure Aufmerksamkeit.
Hello, my name is Nils Lohmann and I work at the University of Rostock, and there we do research on compilers. And in my free time I got a bit obsessed about languages, and I wanted to talk about a project I did in the last year's slide. So when you look at computer languages, you can very easily can be obsessed about how the style of the program is. So when you look on the left, you see that it's a very redundant piece of code that could be replaced by a simple free call. And when you're very nerdy about it, you could start arguing where the braces should go. Should the braces of an if be in the same line, or should there be a new line? And if you look at the right, you can have the same arguments, and there the code is not even redundant, it's also wrong. So it passes the compiler, but then it breaks at runtime. And that is something where at computer science we have some tools to have some limited ideas how to detect these bugs and how to fix these bugs. Slide. On the other hand, we have the English language, which is used in computer sciences for everything we write down. And as a non-native speaker, you start using your English skills from school and you start writing down research papers, and you fail miserably because you try to sound very smart and you use a lot of words, but these a lot of words don't make you feel make it smart, it just makes it embarrassing. And then you have some words or some things you think that is a sentence, and in the end you can replace it by a single word. You try to have a lot of, you have some informal languages, and this is all nothing you want to see in a research paper slide. So when you write down your papers and you give it to your supervisor, you get it back and the whole margin is written down with corrections. And what you actually want to have, you want to have some warnings like in a compiler, which just tells you, well, in line 6 you used a stupid word, you should replace it by another word that doesn't make it look too stupid. Slide. And we have an app for that. This app is called Nitpicker. You can use it online. You enter some text you wrote, you press a button, and in best case it detects some stupid errors that pass the style the type checker, but it's still semantically not correct. So you have some drop downs and you can replace stupid words by more clever words. Slide. And the current state of the project is that we implemented some style guides that you can get in a library, so the Chicago Manual of Style and a nice book for Alain Dupré called Bugs in Writing and other style guides. And it finds some current errors or style errors that you don't want to have in your text and some wrong prepositions. We have a web app currently, and it's based on a JSON API, which is not yet a public slide. Apparently, there are some challenges. First being that English is not context-free, so we can't use standard compilers, write a grammar and push a button. We have a lot of false positives, because if you use some words in one context, it might be nice, in another context, it might be wrong. So there are some, for instance, some rules that say you shouldn't use the word information too often, because it's a non-word, it doesn't mean too much. But if you are in information sciences, apparently use the word a lot. Good style is very subjective, so coming from computer science, I implemented a lot of style guides for computer science. If you're doing physics or mathematics, it might be that computer sciences have a whole different kind of style. And I'm not a native speaker, which makes it even more complicated to implement something clever, but it helps a lot because I can start avoid errors I do again and again. Slide. So, what I want is I want help. I need a lot of people to use it. So I had, up to now, I used it in some computer science papers, got some feedback about it, but I need more people using it. So I need more people telling me what is wrong, or more people telling me about other style guides. I need people who actually know a bit more about natural language. I need a good part of speech tagger. I know there's some around, but they're not like branch on GitHub and you can use it. What would be nice to have some integrators so that in the end you have your paper written in LaTeX, you press a button and you have annotated LaTeX. I need language nerds which like fiddling around with languages as much as I do, so I basically need you and your friends and your friends of friends. On the bottom line, you see an email address where you can send me an email whether you'd like to participate. On the bottom right, you have the URL of the web app, and you can follow me on Twitter, and thanks a lot.
And one quick reminder, and if you could also tell your friends, this applies throughout the conference, on the far plan, where the schedule for the main lectures are, there's always a link there to leave feedback. We're looking forward to seeing what you thought about all of the lectures and the lightning talks especially. So if you could go there, leave feedback, positive or negative, any suggestions for improvement or things that you really liked and you'd like to see again next year, that would be much appreciated. So without any further ado, are you ready? Your 5 minutes starts now.
Hi, next slide, please. I'm Mario Manner from CCC Cologne. I'm organizing the SIGINT, and I was involved on the 29C3 content team, and I'm talking about the conference management system FREP, which is kind of a successor to Pentabuff, which was used this year for the conference. Can you advance the slides like every 20 seconds? Because they are really small. So it's a web-based conference planning system which you can use to manage the conference and create a schedule, get feedback from visitors and stuff like that. It was created by the organizers of the FrostCon and originally by David Reutzel. So it's actually a successor to Pentabuff, which was used in the CCC Congress by the DebConf and others. And basically, it's a rewrite, a complete rewrite, which tries to stay compatible in the important parts. FREP is a logical successor. We have a migration path, and Pentabuff isn't maintained anymore. The last commit is like 3 years ago, and a lot of people have the problem how to upgrade their Pentabuff installation. So FREP is basically Rails. It's standard Rails. It's Rails with a few gems like CanCan for abilities, Haml, and Twitter Bootstrap for the front-end code. So it's easy to adapt and easy to understand. So we feature multi-conference support, and we have role-based access controls for submitters, speakers, organizers. We integrate ticket systems for the communication, RT and OTS at the moment, and we've got a JSON export if you want to program against the schedule. And we're Pentabuff compatible. We have the same XML format. If you had any scripts before that depended on that, they should work. And we are maintainable. We've got tests and database migrations, and we should support the three databases. Yeah, conferences actually using FREP are, of course, the FrostCon for 2 years, the SIGINT conference in Cologne, and several other conferences like the MMCD and the upcoming Hackover conference, for example. So how do you go about making a conference? Because that's actually really simple. You have to create the conference in the software and fill out all the values, like the title of the conference, the acronym of the conference, and give it a subtitle. And then you have to add conference days to the conference. So I spent a lot of time to make this work with actual time frames. So you can have conference skip midnight, for example, because midnight is 0 and 0 is smaller than 23, which is kind of a problem for other softwares. And afterwards, you go into the call for participation phase, where speakers submit their talks. There's a special interface for that. Here's the login page on screen, and the speaker adds his talk and a description and stuff like that. So here, this is the availability screen. Speakers are not there all the time. Some might want to come by only for a few hours, so they can use these nifty slider controls to set up their availabilities. This is, again, real time, so no problems are to be expected there. And afterwards, you go and have the talks reviewed. And the reviewing process is here an example image of an example review. So you can just give some stars at a comment to the talk, and afterwards you can look at the talks and decide by the reviews if the community thinks that's a good talk. So we have a review role, which is only allowed to review talks and not to accept or reject the talk. So afterwards, you have to go and fill out all the details. You have to ask the speakers for more information and inform them of acceptance or rejectance of their talks. And this is done by coordinators, and they manage the individual speakers. Of course, there's conferences which only have one or two people organizing the content, then it's obviously it's easier. So this is a person page. It's just an example from software. You can see the other conferences. If the speaker is already known, you can decide by this information if you want to have them again, and then you can plan your actual schedule for your conference. You can drag and drop these events and put them there, and afterwards you can publish the schedule. And here is the conflict management. So if the speaker isn't there, there would be a conflict here which you could resolve later. Yeah, then you can look at some statistics about your conference and basically go about and actually do the conference. We have a static schedule export, just like Pentabath has, so people can download static pages, which is important for the performance of the whole thing. Yeah, so in the future we want to have a plugin system. We have plans on video integration. We want a better review system, like top 10 lists or something. And we definitely want subconference support to give more people the opportunity to actually work on content. Yeah, if you want to contact us, and then just via the mailing list or contact me in Java, and just fork the project on GitHub, start developing, and give us a pull request. Thanks.
All right. Now, this lightning talk, there is a special little bit at the end, because you attempted to submit a lightning talk last year, and there's a story about that at the end. So that won't count against your time because I messed up last year, so I have to give you that. But without any further ado, are you ready to start your main presentation?
Yeah.
Go.
All right. My talk is about a system we have in my Hackerspace Labitat, which is for tracking all the inventory that you have in space, all the tools and other equipment that you have, and some of that is led to us by members. Slide. So, for example, this is a print milling machine that we have, which has a label done in front of it. Slide. Which you see here that it has a QR code and an ID, and then has a couple of tags, like the do or not hack. And then has the sign in the middle that means that you need to read the manual first. Yeah, next. So this is the page for creating new tags, where it in real time generates the PNG in the browser, and then when you save it, it regenerates it with the right ID, and it uploads it to the backend of it and prints it on the printer. Next. And also it's full text search support. This is implemented using Postgres. And next. So the QR code that is, includes a URL to a redirection service that we have at LabTat, which then redirects to our wiki, where we have a template for LabTrack entries. And the other tag that is that's possible to have on the labels, that is a personal property of a member. And next slide. So the backend is written in something called Lua Event Machine that is written by Emil, that is sitting over there in the corner. It's basically it's sort of like Node.js with having, but apart from that, it uses coroutines to make asynchronous coding just like it was synchronous, so that it pauses the coroutine whenever it would block. And then has the print queue and so on, and it's pretty basic. So this is the printer on top of our fridge in the space. And if you take the next slide. So usually this printer only has a 32-bit driver by a brother. So it doesn't really work on 64-bit server. So we take next slide. So we reverse engineered it from the USB communication and wrote a new driver in C, which reads the PNG and writes directly to the character device created by Linux kernel USB driver for printers. And currently, LabTrack is deployed in our own space and in Zulu Room. Next up will probably be Knightsbridge. And I've heard that our member in the San Francisco area have around 6 or 7 other spaces lined up. Yeah, next slide. So the roadmap for this is to get some versioning control, because right now everyone can go in and just modify a label so it, and with no way to revert it other than the database backup. And improving the search so that you can search for subwords and not just the full text search support by Postgres. Yule is also working on implementing a distributed search across hackerspaces. And we also would like to have some gallery with different stickers and stuff that you might want to print out regularly. So the source is at these URLs. And I'll recommend you to check out the Lua event machine. That's basically it.
And now, very quickly, the missing talk about the Lua event machine and the story behind it.
Yeah. Last year, I pushed Esmiel for holding a talk about his event machine. I haven't succeeded in it yet. At a party last year, we submitted a talk anyway. But Nick didn't receive it. We'll take next slide. We just did it with Sunnet on a projector in the Rumfahrtagentur hackerspace in Berlin. The next slide, you see that Google actually accepts the mail, but Nick didn't get it. So the next one, yeah, we also thought Nick should have that information. So maybe there'll be a talk about Lua event machine at some point in time. I don't know.
But yes, I searched my mail extensively for this and occasionally ping back and try to find it. But nope, this talk somehow got accepted by Google but never made it to me, unfortunately. So perhaps sometime in 2 years it'll magically appear out of the ether. But quick round of applause just for the missing.
Please.
Oh, okay. You were going to use your own laptop, so I think we're going to have to switch over to the video over there.
Are you...
I'll unplug me.
Well, it's okay.
You're good? Okay. And your 5 minutes starts now.
Okay. So I'm Paul Rascanier. We'll present you my project, malware.lu, and a tool that we released last month. So malware.lu is maintained by 4 people, me and 3 others. And the focus, the purpose of the project is to share malware samples to researchers. So to present the project, I've put some numbers. For the moment, we share more than 4 million of unique samples. And we have a second part of the project is to provide technical article about malware analysis. And actually, we've got 26 articles. These 4 million of samples take 7 gigabytes of disk. And we've got a database to be able to search a specific sample. And the database use 7 gigabytes. The malware take 3 terabytes of data. And we try to make money to buy business of reverse engineering or malware analysis of or incident response. So to have an account on malware.lu, we don't provide a classic form with you put your username, etc., etc. To have an account, you have to write an email to us and explain why you want an account, and after that, we create the account. For the moment, we've got more than 1,000 of users, so we are not really strict. So you're able to make to search a specific sample with the hash of malware, but with the name too. In fact, we use the name provided by antivirus. So if you would like, for example, sample linked to Stuxnet, you can simply enter Stuxnet in the second form, and you've got all sample in the relationship with Stuxnet. Once you find the specific sample you would like to download, you get some information as the name of it by antivirus. So we are looking for people to this project to give us some sample. Maybe we don't have a complete database and you've got some interesting sample to put on it. And we're looking for people interesting to write technical article as an article to explain how to unpack specific malware, blah, blah, blah. And we released a first tool on called Malwasp. You can download it, it's open source, you can download it on Google Code. And I put online a demo to test it. You can connect to http://malwasp.com and you've got the application online. In fact, this application is a plugin, an extension to Qcos Sandbox. In fact, the malware that you would like to analyze is start in a virtual machine managed by VirtualBox, and our tool monitor all the activity of the malware. All the activity is register value, flag value, instructions, stacks, heap data, all memory information during the execution of the malware. All this information is stored on a database, and you've got a web browser to be able to navigate on the data stored in the database. Most simple things is to show you a demo. So you, if you are used to use a debugger, is an offline debugger on your browser. Here, I don't show you the malware executing in the virtual machine, blah, blah, blah. It's a little bit long, but you've got here the results. And it's like a classic debugger. You can
1 minute.
Use it and hit execute. You've got all register at the right, and you can, as a classic debugger, make following dump, and the memory value is automatically updated here. Here you've got a timeline to go where you want to go on the execution. That's all for me. Thanks.
Hello, everybody. My name is Harold, and I would like to tell you a little bit about a project of bringing the technology and humanities together. That's a cool project that we are trying in Braunschweig, Germany, and I would like to tell you a little bit about it. First of all, what is entrepreneurship at all? An entrepreneur is a person who is setting up a business, a so-called startup. But I believe that sounds a little bit like it's all about making money, but I believe an entrepreneur is not someone, entrepreneurship is not about making money. Entrepreneurship is actually about great ideas. Next slide, please. It's not about making money, it's about great ideas. It's about better ideas than previous ones. It's about making something really genuinely new. And that's also what hacking is about. And I believe the creativity that we are all doing as hackers and the creativity of our entrepreneurs is not much different to innovation in the industry. And let's take a look at Wikipedia at the definition of what hacking is. That says the act of engaging in activities is in a spirit of playfulness and exploration is termed hacking. Hacking entails some form of excellence, for example, exploring the limits of what is possible. And hacking, as we've seen in many examples before, is often taking things apart in order to understand it and put it together in an originally unintended manner. We also see that in art sometimes. In 1947, Picasso took apart a bicycle saddle and a handlebar and put it into a new context and formed this bull's head. And that's creativity, and we could use that creative thinking also in order to solve problems in the industry. One example is the cell phone industry. Not long ago, as about 6 years ago, this mobile phone industry had two problems that came from its megatrends. One megatrend was miniaturization, that is, everything becomes smaller. The other one was convergence, that means more and more functions get into a smaller and smaller device. And that causes, of course, a problem in the interface. And that was solved, of course, not by Nokia, who had great engineers and great managers, but by a company that had creative thinkers at its core. And that was, of course, slow down, please, with the fire. That was, of course, Apple, because they solved that problem of the industry by applying a touchscreen interface with a software keyboard that is only visible when it's useful. So, and Steve Jobs, now we come to the quote on the next slide, said, part of what made the Macintosh great was that the people working on it were musicians and poets and artists and zoologists and historians who also happened to be the best computer scientists in the world. And we can solve such problems only, he said, next slide, if we are at the intersection of technology and liberal arts or humanities, if you like. And that's a great chance for a university. And that's what we are trying to establish in Braunschweig, because next slide, we have two universities there, an artistic university, that's the Braunschweig University of Arts, and the Technical University. At the University of Arts, we offer degrees in the Fine Arts, in Industrial Design, Visual Design, and Media Studies. The University of Technology offers degrees in Economics, Life Science, Engineering, and Computer Science as well. And what we're trying to do is bring those two worlds together in order to foster creative thinking and real creativity that is not only 10% better, but 10 times better. That is next slide, that we do joint efforts. We do lightning talks like this one at first in order to understand each other's thinking, each other's ideas, each other's projects. We are making network events to bring those people together. We establish joint projects and host them in so-called co-working spaces. And we offer them advice and funding for those entrepreneurs. If you, this is a great and inspiring project. And if you want to know more about our project, next slide, this slide, please. Or if you know other similar projects that we can learn from, please get in contact with me as soon as possible. Thanks very much.
Okay.
All good?
Yes, ready. So my name is not super important. I am a cryptologist and code breaker based in London. I would like to advertise a group at LinkedIn, which is called Code Breakers, which already was advertised yesterday at one talk. This group is really everything which you think you could be code breaking. So it's different things for different people, like data security, cryptography, cryptanalysis, hacking, digital forensics, and a few other things. If you look at a few other groups which exist at LinkedIn, so some of them are listed here. So it's quite interesting, because I think you should maybe take some time to compare people who are in these groups. So in some of these groups, you find amazing people, amazing specialists, which have very high age index. You can find with Google Scholar, they have a lot of publications, they are major universities, they are major corporations, they know a lot of things. And yet some of these groups, they have almost, in my opinion, nobody who really is a specialist in cryptography or cryptanalysis, yet they are here on LinkedIn. So I think we need to thank LinkedIn for introducing quite recently a system for certifying the expertise of other people, which is a very helpful tool they have recently introduced. Because otherwise, maybe you might end up being a member of the wrong group. So I leave you as an exercise to see which one of these groups is a slightly strange group. It's here on this picture. Another thing which we want to promote in this group is solidarity. So we promote solidarity between code breakers from all walks of life, okay? So now maybe you think there is no need for solidarity of code breakers. Okay, so I will speak from experience. So maybe you think that there is no censorship in today's research. Maybe you think that major universities promote independent scientific research, while in fact they promote corruption and nepotism. Maybe you think that journalists would by default write the truth and the lies are easy to dismiss. Maybe you think that the market will determine a fair price for your work and nobody would steal it. Maybe you think that people who are visibly your friends, you are still your friends when they are under the cover of anonymity in a program committee. You think that research should be free ideas, source code, should be free and available on open platforms, and all the large corporate profits were earned by hard work, and yet there is no relation between the two facts. Maybe you think that banks will need to prove that what they say is true in a court of law. Well, actually, they will not have to prove that it's true. Maybe you think that Alan Turing obviously did eat cyanide and another British mathematician's prodigy actually did close himself in a plastic bag to commit suicide. So in that case, maybe you believe that codebreaker solidarity is not important. Okay, next slide, please. Yeah, this was the next slide. So just one more remark about the group. It is a closed group, so we check requests to join. So the minimum kind of level of expertise we require is a sort of Master of Science thesis in security relevant topics level or equivalent professional experience. And so we just don't admit anybody, and the group is not open, so what is posted in the group is only visible to members. Thank you very much, and please join.
Okay, I never got slides from Crunch about data mining the open cloud. Okay. Web out of browsers. Theo, are you? Okay, great, awesome. And then this is the second to the last talk. The last talk is a presentation on LibreOffice, and then we have a very, very special bonus surprise at the end. So are you guys ready to go? All good?
Yes.
Okay, and then don't forget, all you have to say is just slide when you want the next slide. Cool?
Hi, I'm Phlogistic, this is Theo, and this is Alf, and we're building a community and application collection for accessing data from websites, and that's called Weboob. Slide. So what's Weboob? Weboob is a collection of applications that lets you access, modify, and download and do stuff to data. Usually you will use a web browser to access, and then you can do it without a web browser. Technically, it consists of this collection of applications and a collection of APIs that try to unify the functionalities of websites for accessing them in a unified way. Slide. So this is an example of how it works. We got three applications for watching videos. One is called Videoob and it works in command line. One is graphical and one is web-based, but they all use the same unified API, so the implementation is really simple and they access several video models. Slide, Theo.
Yeah. So basically, most of websites work the same way.
here we have some video websites, so they're all the same. If you go on Arte or Canal Plus or Vimeo, you just want to search for videos and play videos. So you're doing the same thing if you go on YouPorn or the European Parliament website. You just want to get the videos. But you are a pervert if you go on the European Parliament website. Slide, please. Same thing applies for Weaver websites. You just want to select a CD and get forecasts. Slide. Slide, please. Here again, same thing for torrents. You just want to get torrents and download the torrents because you are a nasty pirate. Slide, please. So why do we use Weboob? It's better for privacy. You don't download the crap, you know, Twitter, Facebook, follow me on anything, Google Plus One. The web is bloated. Each page you get in a browser, you get a shitload of JavaScript, CSS, images, videos, and flash stuff, crap. You don't get that with Weboob. It's accessible. Most web pages are not accessible to blind people because screen reader can't read it, or people that can aim precisely to with a mouse. Weboob just gives pure data and is more accessible. It's hackable. You can use anything that goes on, that goes out Weboob in SED, AUK, GREP, or anything, and it's faster. With one query, you can query dozens of websites. Slide, please.
And of course, possibilities of Weboob are the same as this website that we interact with. We have an application, for example, to find a house, where you can export read paper, a newspaper in an article in a readable format that takes in email or a file for your ebook readers. And you can optimize your sexual life with on a dating website. Slide, please. Short, an overview on a particular application, very popular in France. We support more than 15 bank websites, and we can access on your balance, your history of transaction, your coming operation, as well as make transfer, money transfer. And we have the support of Butch Insight. This is a startup on the make money with a solution based on a Weboob. Slide, please. Und für unser deutsches Publikum haben wir leider nicht so viel zu admitten, aber wir haben schon ein paar Module. Wir haben zwei Zeitungen, die bekannte Tageszeitung und Presse Europe, die eigentlich Artikel auf ganz Europa übersetzt in Fremdsprache. Und wir haben auch die Sernistische Hochwasserlage in Sachsen. Und zum Beispiel, Sie können wissen, dass wir Dresden heute Alarmstufe 1 erreicht. Slide, please. Und yes, to contact us, you can use see your website, there is a lot of information on channel IRC. Thank you.
All right, and you're all good? This is, I believe, just one quick question. Did anybody attempt to submit a lightning talk and get absolutely no response over email? Okay, good. That was comforting. I just wanted to take that quick second. Everything good?
Yes.
Okay, 5 minutes starts now.
Okay, I'm Björn Michaelsen. I'm an elected member of the board of the Document Foundation, and I want to talk a little bit about LibreOffice and the Document Foundation, the institution behind it. Next slide. So first, why should you care? Currently, the alternatives are, well, you can use Microsoft Office and SharePoint, and that's not hackable, it's closed source, and it's not fun to work with. Or you can put all your data in the cloud and hope nobody does anything evil with it. I think we need a third alternative, which is an open source solution. Next. So LibreOffice was announced as a fork of OpenOffice in September 2010, and the intent was to get it more independent of one corporate sponsor and get more people involved. And next slide, thank you. And as forks happen, there are epic flame fests, and I was working at Oracle at that point in time, so I took my part in that and said this all won't work, and this is tricky, and people, next slide, told me different, and 6 months later, I joined another company and was not with Oracle anymore. Next slide. which, as it turns out, both the fork and changing my employer was probably a good decision, because only 6 weeks later, Oracle announced that OpenOffice will become a community project, which is buzzword for we will fire everyone in Hamburg. And so it was good probably for LibreOffice and for me to join another company. So with the foundation, next slide please. That took a while, probably because we're not only five old farts trying to evade taxes, but actually do something a bit more tricky, which was, next slide, we wanted to protect the foundation against being hijacked by one corporate entity. And to do that, we had the members of the TDF based only on contribution. You can't buy your way in. So you have to contribute to the project to become a member. And from that on, you elect everyone. You elect the guys who allow others to go become members, and you also elect the board of directors and the people who make all the other decisions. Next slide. So did we do any work? Well, I could talk about features, but that would take an hour, just for the new stuff we did in 2012. So I'll just put up some numbers, and below you see a lot of public entities going with LibreOffice and moving to it. So this is quite good. Next. And our downloads also look good and are getting better and better. So how does it work with actually getting a community involved and not only one or multiple corporate entities? Slide. Well, you can see the hackfests here. The first one up in the left is in Hamburg in the attractor. In the lower right, you see the Hackfest in Munich, which was at the Linux project. And you can see we attract quite a big crowd, and we use our donations, for example, to fly developers in from everywhere to that. So those all happened for the second time, and we will continue with them. Next slide. Again, for you need a corporate sponsor to do that. This is the LibreOffice conference in Berlin. That's roundly 200 people in three tracks over 3 days. And it's in the Ministry of Economics and Technology. So, well, yeah, you can do that with a community. Next slide. There's lots of other stuff. By the way, we were at FOSDEM last year. We will be at FOSDEM next year. So if you're interested in more technical talks, we have a dev room there. Please join. Thanks. Next slide. Apropos technical topics, this is one example of what happened. You know bisecting, maybe, which is searching for a regression. Okay. Which is searching for regression in the progress. And for LibreOffice, you can't do that. Building LibreOffice 20 times is not an option. Next slide. So what we did is put 262 LibreOffice builds in one Git repository, the binaries. And with that, QA engineers can walk through 18 months of LibreOffice history and find when the bug was introduced without ever compiling LibreOffice once. And all that is in 60 megs for one compile. So it compresses excellently.
30 seconds.
Next slide. I also have LibreOffice running on a Nexus 7, just for if you want to look at it, can show you later. Next slide. The long tail of LibreOffice development shows you, well, we have a lot of contributors who are small contributors. This is good because you can, with five commits, become part of that. And it is also good for the project because to get more of those, we need more of those. Thank you.
And now the moment that at least three people were waiting for. Because it would not be a lightning talk session without bringing back the gentleman that has keys.
I have keys. Yeah. I have keys for all. And I offer one key for 1 giga euro. This is next. Next, for the airport Tempelhof, I buy the airport, the whole airport, because I have keys.
next. And I offer one key for 1024. Do you see it? Next. And this is, I make last year a mistake about a few millions, and this is now right. This is 1 giga euro. I offer one key. You can pay and buy this key, and for the other keys for 1 million, you can only pay a deposit. Next. So then we built a machine, a temple machine, at the Temple of Afield, and we rocked their endless celebration. 8,760 hours every year, and sometimes one day longer. Next. So it looks inside. Next. At the Temple of Afield. Next. There, in the middle of Tempelhof. Next. Next. Yes, we do it. Next. The machine inside. Next. From above. And next. So, then we dance a lot, and we see us then in the machine at Tempelhof. I hope the next years. Yeah, next. So, if you want to donate, you can do it next year. I have keys then also in steel or copper or silver or in gold, and you can only pay a deposit for this because we need an interest, and we made the party then from the interest of the money. Next. So, you will find me or us there, and follow for news at Twitter. Next. So, thanks a lot, and then we see us in the machine to the party. So, and I have here some stickers with love, and you can get them, the stickers at the entrance. Okay, thanks.
All right, I believe that's everybody, and that is the final round of lightning talks. Please stick around if you were interested in taking part in the flash mob later on today. How many people have shown up for that? Okay, other than that, please, a huge round of applause for the lightning talks. Everybody that presented, everybody that that took part, and everybody that participated, and everybody that tried to submit but couldn't get in. Thank you.